the leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
If you want to work until you keel over, have less of everything in retirement, or give back more of your hard-earned money to the stock market again, then just ignore me. But if you'd like to protect the money you save, receive a steady, predictable retirement income, and enjoy financial security for as long as you live, then listen to this. You can download a free report that reveals the wealth-building secrets Wall Street and the banks don't want you to know. You'll learn how you can get guaranteed growth, safety, and real prosperity without risking your money in the Wall Street casino, and how to get the money you need when you need it, simply by asking for it. This is the best way to have a 100% secure retirement and know your money will last as long as you do. To learn more about this method and to get your free report, go to 29security.com. That's the number 29security.com. 29security.com. Go to 29security.com.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If you're vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
All right, folks, this is Rick Robinson with you. I want to tell you about some friends of mine from a company called Security Enforcement Specialists. When I ran my security agency for 12 years, I worked with one of these partners on a daily basis. He's been involved in this agency now, and with his other partner, they do have over 30 years of experience in the private security industry. If you own a business and you need someone to keep you or your customers or residents safe, then I highly recommend contacting Security Enforcement Specialists today. Give them a call at 405-703-1796. Again, that's 405-703-1796. Again, tell them Rick from K98 Talk sent you. Like I said, if you need the help, they are here for you. So make sure that you go look them up, check them out, and see what they can do. The wrong way. Welcome to the place.
J. Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Laura.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
The Internet will never be the same. You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Good God, y'all.
What is it good for?
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome, everybody, and welcome, fellow patriots. Welcome once again to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show. I'm Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360 in Philadelphia, and around the world on the Internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio Network, AM/FM 24/7, and a whole bunch of others. This gets longer, longer, longer. But joining me today as my co-host is the patriot of the Commonwealth of Virginia, the president and CEO of Frontiers of Freedom, and that's my good friend George Landreth. George, welcome back to Conservative Commandos Radio Show.
Thank you, Rick. It's always good to be here.
Great to have you.
It's like almost home. Yeah. Pretty darn close.
Pretty darn close. And George, are you getting all ready for the blizzard of the century down in Northern Virginia in D.C. area this summer or tomorrow?
I think I'm as ready as I'm going to be. The question is my lower back ready? We'll see.
Well, you know, George, with all your money, you should hire some kids to shovel your snow.
Yeah, with all my money. I actually have some. It's actually the better phrase would be with all those kids. I should get some of them to shovel. And they will, actually. But I always
You got a boatload of children yourself there, don't you?
That's what I tell them. I always tell them when things like this come up, why do you think we had you?
Well, you know, in parts, it was really laughable, George. Last year, we had a pretty big snow, and some industrious people, young people, went around door to door to shovel snow, and they got arrested by the police for peddling without a license.
Oh, my goodness. What delinquents. You know, I understand that going out and shoveling snow without a license is kind of like a gateway drug, and it leads to, you know, much worse things. You don't want kids to learn to be hardworking, enterprising too early. They could go awry with that.
That would be horrible, wouldn't it?
Oh, terrible.
That would be absolutely horrible. Well, George, it's great to have you with me today. What's on your radar screen?
Well, I was, one of the things I thought was kind of interesting, it's a bit of German news, but the reality is it applies to us. But am I correct in my recollection that Angela Merkel won, the Time Person of the Year award just like, 21 or 22 days ago?
Well,
that's my recollection, is that Angela Merkel was, and it was because of how well she was handling the whole question of refugees and all this stuff, she was doing all the things the liberals thought she should be doing. She was being welcoming and so forth. Well, today, the headline in one of the German publications is Merkel's last stand, question mark. Chancellor running out of time on refugee issue. So basically something happened like 2 days after she won the Time magazine honor. And that was New Year's. And they've done, I think tried to hide what has been going on. It's actually not a new phenomenon. This has been going for a couple of years now. And that is, there's a certain group that seems not to understand that you can't sexually assault women simply because they haven't covered their face or they're not wearing what you think is the required garb. And so, but this has finally kind of broke into the news, and now all of a sudden we're finding out this has been going on, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, everyone, I'm sure, is aware that on New Year's Eve in Cologne, there was apparently kind of like mass sexual assaults going on by essentially what have been described by all the witnesses as, you know, kind of Middle Eastern men. And many of them have been arrested and questioned, and they
call them what they are. They're Muslims, George. They're Muslims.
Well, I understand, but you can't describe someone you saw necessarily as a Muslim just because that's a religion, and, you know, who knows? I mean, yeah. I know Muslims that wear suits and, you know, are clean-shaven and, you know, look like you and I, is my point. But the news accounts say that they were Middle Eastern men. But you're right. These are Muslim men. It's just that they didn't necessarily, you know, they were wearing Middle Eastern garb, but that's what I was getting to. These are Muslim men. They come from countries where evidently women are viewed differently. I would argue this gets us back to this question of who we invite to come to our country. And we have to invite people that we think share our values and our worldviews and our perspective. And if your worldview is that a woman who is not covered from ankle to the top of her head, including the top of her head, is it's okay for you to sexually assault her, then I don't think we need to invite you here. And quite frankly, I don't care where you go to church on Sunday or Saturday or Friday.
George, all these people need is a little bit of sensitivity training, don't you think?
No, actually, no, in Germany, they're talking about doing sensitive training for Germans because the question are German women, are Swedish, are Norwegian women being not sensitive to the cultural differences. And so when they go up and talk to a man, say at a nightclub, are they sending the wrong signal? Because he thinks she wants to jump in the sack. And he just doesn't get that that's not what she means. She's just being social.
George, they just need to
be... And it's their fault. Talk about blaming the victim. I mean, good grief.
George,
Ever Hillary talked about blaming the victim again, I think I will want to strangle her.
George, they just need to learn and understand that no means no, and they'll stop doing it, George, you know.
Yeah. Well, this I view this as a complicated a problem, not complicated in the sense we don't know how to fix it, but complicated in the sense that I don't think that you can just give them sensitivity training. It'd be easy to say, because that's what they're trying to do now. They've now divulged they've been having sensitivity training for immigrants now for the past 3 years. That's obviously not working. But I don't think you can tell them, by the way, just because someone's wearing Western clothes and says hello, it doesn't mean that you can rape her. I would think you should understand that. But secondly, if you can't get that, then you don't have what it takes to survive and be successful in our society. So you shouldn't be in our society. You should be somewhere else. Don't come here because you do not have what it takes to succeed. All you have to take to succeed, you're going to succeed in landing yourself in jail and clogging our court system and filling up our jails. And we don't need that. And they don't need that. So, you know, stay somewhere else and don't come here. I mean, again, this isn't about, I don't care where you go to church. I care how you behave once you're here. Mm-hmm. If you want to blow me up, if you want to rape my neighbors, my family, my friends, anybody in my society, we don't need you. And I do not understand why this is such a difficult concept, but this is what this whole story. Angela Merkel is trumpeted Time Magazine Person of the Year. She's so awesome. She's so wonderful. And the month is not even done yet. The magazine is no longer printed, obviously, but were it still printed, it would be on the newsstands.
Well, George,
and now talking about, I was at a meeting yesterday where the question asked of every participant was to ask us, would she survive in office till till July 1st? In other words, would her party say, you are done, you've got to go, you're too radioactive, we have to remarket our party, you got to go, Ms. Merkel? And I don't know if she's gone yet or not. I do know this, she will not serve another term. And what this demonstrates is the craziness of political correctness and the unwillingness to deal with this problem that exists in so much of Washington.
Well, her troubles cease to end, George. She is actually being sued. She's being sued right now by 200 migrants in a lawsuit against her, claiming that the asylum proceedings are taking too long in their case. So she's being sued by these same people she's letting into her country.
They would go faster if they weren't having to arrange to get out of jail for once they've been arrested for rape to make their asylum hearings. That's the problem.
It does indeed. It does indeed.
I'm being facetious, of course, but I mean, it's obviously all of them. But the point is, again, now someone's going to, but George, not everyone's raping. It's kind of like, I understand that. I didn't say that every single person in Germany that's come from Syria is a rapist. But clearly, it's a significant number, and it's way too big a number to accept. If it were one in a million, you'd go, okay, well, I don't know if we can, that just happens. I mean, you know, you get a million of anybody, and there's probably somebody that's bad. But this is simply not acceptable, and I... Again, no, these people do not have a constitutional right to enter Germany, the United States, or any other country. There is no right to demand entrance to another country. And so we need to stop acting like it's their right. It is not their right. The question is, do we want to allow them to enter? And that's a privilege that we grant, not a right they have.
Well, George, what about all these people, even in this country, who think that regardless of who they are, where they come from, or where they're at now, should have all the rights and privileges of being a U.S. citizen and all the rights and privileges afforded citizens under the Constitution?
Well, you know, it's interesting. There are, historically... I wouldn't say this in the United States throughout all of history. There are certain things that applied just when you were here. But obviously, like, for example, citizens vote. You, just because you're here on vacation or you're living here or even if you're here illegally, I don't care if you've been here for 30 years. If you're not a citizen, you don't have any right to vote. The right to vote is not based on presence. Now, if you're physically present, I think you have the right, for example, for the police not to, you still have some due process rights, meaning like if you're here on vacation, the police can't kick down your hotel door, beat you up and, steal your luggage. You know, I mean, so I'm not suggesting that you have no rights, but there is this odd idea that everybody in the world has constitutional rights and that you don't even have to be here. You can, it's crazy because if that's the case, then the world is unmanageable because you have literally billions of people who have the right to be here, and we can't say no. So if they say, I'd like to come in, we can't because it's their country too. It's like, that's crazy talk. That's not practical. It's not real. It's never what the founders intended. And they gave explicit authority to Congress to create a system of naturalization. They did not create it as a right. There's no amendment or any place in the Constitution that suggests as a right. It basically said Congress will make rules, and they'll decide who can come here and who can't.
Well, George, we are up against the break right now. You're listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360 in Philly. and around the world on the internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio, and AM/FM 24/7, in addition to a bunch of others. Today's show, like all our shows, is brought to you by the First Amendment and protected by the Second. Both of them are under attack. We honor them here. Don't go away, George, and I'll be right back.
The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos radio network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos radio show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos radio show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos radio show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando radio show.
You're right. This is the Conservative Commandos radio show with George Landreth and yours truly, Rick Trader. And for rebroadcasts of our shows, check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. At 1 p.m., please log on to roarradio.net. At 9 p.m., highplainsdailynews.com. You could also listen to our show any time of the day from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. Local program note, here in Deptford Township, New Jersey, the Board of Education wants to raise $100 million in taxes with a bond issue that they're proposing. Well, this Saturday at noontime, we are rebroadcasting a special program that we did here at WNJC 1360 with some community leaders last week, asking the pertinent question, will all this money go to help with better student outcomes? So again, please listen in. If you're in Deptford Township, New Jersey, please listen in this Saturday at 12 noon. It concerns you, It's going to raise your taxes anywhere from $300 a year to $1,000 a year. So please be informed. Hey, George, let's go over our guest list today, and I will start. And joining us today at 3:35 will be Andrew Campanella. He's the president of National School Choice Week. And Andrew is going to be joining us to talk about National School Choice Week, which is we're in it right now, actually. Well, actually, it starts January 24th. So it's next week, January 24th through January 30th. And school choice is something that I'm in favor for. I think any right-thinking American should be. But, you know, government is like a dictatorship. They make you send your kids to the schools that they say you can send your children to. George,
well, this is an interesting thought when you think about this.
Yeah.
We might ask him about this, but my experience is if you send your kids to a Catholic school, they're going to get a pro-Catholic education. If you send them to an Episcopalian school, they'll get a pro-Episcopalian. If you send them to a Baptist school, they'll get a pro-Baptist. If you send them to a government school, what are they going to get? They're going to get a pro-government education. And what they're going to be taught is that big government's a good thing, and they're going to learn the wrong things about government, not what our founding fathers intended to learn, which is that you need government, but you need to keep it in check, and you need to check and balance it because it has some problems, too.
Well, you know, George, the thing that gets me about public schools versus Catholic schools, private schools, as you heard me mention, that we have a local bond issue that's going up for vote in March, and they want to raise $100 million, one-tenth of $1 billion. It's what the school board wants to play with. They say it's going to help student outcomes, but it's all for brick and mortar, George. It's things like to put new seating and new carpeting in the high school auditorium, a new catwalk in the high school auditorium, a new stage. I don't see how that helps student outcomes. But I did a little research. And Deptford Township is spending almost $17,000 a year per student when you consider that they have a budget of $73 million a year, and there's around 4,200 students. Well, you do a little simple math, it comes up to about $17,000 a year per student. However, when you look at Catholic schools, tuition at a couple local Catholic schools in this area, Camden Catholic and Gloucester Catholic, is less than $9,000 a year. For a Catholic education for an elementary school student, for a Catholic, it's about $4,500 a year. For a non-Catholic, it's about $6,500 a year. So how can the private schools educate a child for so much less than the public schools? And everything that I've heard and have ever known, a child in a Catholic school is going to get a lot better outcome out of their education than in the public schools. I don't understand why it takes like three times as much money or twice as much money to send a child to a public school than it does a private school.
Waste, fraud, and abuse.
So, George, who are you going to be speaking with at 4:05?
At 4:05, we're going to have Ryan Young on, and he's with the Competitive Enterprise Institute. I know a lot of the fellows over there. They're great. They focus on regulatory and monetary policy and regulations. And he's going to look at both our federal regulations and how they're getting out of hand, but also how the left is using the court system through suing, and then, you know, basically what you get is some group that's supportive of some uber-left thing, whatever the policy may be. They sue the government, the EPA, for example, and say, oh, we want you to not allow anyone to fish or swim or to do it, you know, whatever. And then the EPA goes, oh, yeah, you're right, we shouldn't be doing that. And so then they enter into this collusive, because they both agree, agreement that's an out-of-court settlement that then has the force of law. And so there's talk about how to stop that from happening, because what we've seen in the last 40 years is that the left has basically gone and sued various federal agencies, found somebody within that agency who is amenable to their cause. They then throw up the white flag instead of defending the suit and pointing out that the people have the right, for example, to swim in the lake or whatever the case may be. They agree, and slowly but surely they end up regulating us to death, and no legislator there, none of our elected officials have ever cast a vote.
Yeah.
Nobody who's been voted into office has cast a single vote, but we're having to live in that. So it should be a very, very interesting conversation.
Okay, at 4:35, we're going to be joined by Kyle Felcher. He is the energy and environment reporter for the Washington Examiner. And, George, I don't know if you've heard about this. I've seen some reports. It's great that we're going to speak with Kyle today. But apparently there is a problem with the water in Flint, Michigan. I think Flint, Michigan is the home of that Michael Moore guy. And apparently that...
Yeah, obviously drank a lot of that polluted water.
Yeah, well, apparently the lead in the water levels have tripled over the past months or so since they changed their water source. And I guess it's because Michael Moore took a bath in the Flint River or something like that. But we're going to be joined by Kyle Felcher. We're going to be joined by Kyle Felcher, and he's going to bring us up to date on what is happening with the water in Flint, Michigan. Hey, George, let's take our break now, and you are listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360 in Philly, and around the world on the internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio, and AM/FM 24/7. Don't go away. George and I will be right back with our very first guest, Andrew Campanella from School Choice Week.
Yeah, that's my prerogative.
You've heard Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters Morning Show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses, such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years of experience to work for you, as choosing the right option for your situation can be critical. Call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485904.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our Constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems program, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCS for automation.com. That's PCS, the number four, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard. From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader. And if you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of our shows, please check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com, or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. At 1 p.m., roarradio.net, or at 9 p.m., log on to highplainsdailynews.com. But you could also hear our show any time of the day from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. You know, there's a lot of things I look forward to in January, and usually in January, we speak with our next guest. Andrew Campanella is the president of the National School Choice Week. He is an outspoken advocate for providing all children with access to effective, excellent educational environments. And as president of National School Choice Week, Andrew works with hundreds of organizations and thousands of schools to increase the public awareness of school choice in all of its forms. Andrew, welcome back to Conservative Commandos Radio Show.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me back. I appreciate it.
Well, in essence, welcome back home, because you were raised and went to school right here in Washington Township, New Jersey.
That's exactly right. I'm a WTHS grad, and it's good to be back. If by telephone, I am back.
Well, Andrew, it's great to have you. Always look forward to this conversation with you about National School Choice Week. Before we get into that, Andrew, I want to draw you into a local debate that's going on here. Washington Township is right next to Deptford Township.
Right.
Deptford Township, the Board of Education, is going to have the voters, or at least some of the voters that they want, to vote on a bond issue in March, on March 8th, for $100 million, a $100 million bond issue, Andrew. If you do the math, that's one-tenth of $1 billion. When you go over this bond issue, it's for brick and mortar. I don't see where this is going to lead to better outcomes for the students of Deptford Township, New Jersey. And when I equate the amount of money that public education spends to educate a child, and when you take Deptford's budget, which is $73 million a year that they get from the taxpayer to educate about 4,300 students. Andrew, that's about $17,000 a year. $17,000 a year per student. But when I look at the cost of educating students in local private high schools and elementary schools, for instance, in Gloucester and in Camden Catholic, which I'm sure you're aware of, it's about $9,000 a year. And in Holy Trinity Elementary School in Deptford, New Jersey, it's about $6,500 a year. So, Andrew, what I'm getting at is the importance of giving parents the opportunity of school choice. If they had a real choice, maybe of where to send their students to school, maybe they wouldn't be asking for $100 million for more building.
That's a really good point.
I mean, because it seems to me, if parents had the choice of where to send their children to school, that a lot of those children would be going to private schools close to Deptford and inside of Deptford Township, New Jersey, for a whole lot less than it would cost for more building, upgrading the school gymnasium and the auditorium and things that really will not bring benefit to the outcome of the students. So help me out. Am I looking at this correct, Andrew?
Yeah, I think you are. I think there are a few things at play here. Number one, I am familiar with Deptford, by the way, because my first job in life was at the Deptford Mall.
Oh, there you go.
I'm familiar. And I think $100 million for bricks and mortar, you know, it's interesting because you have to ask, have they explored every possible option? Have they considered a charter school? Have they considered multiple charter schools? Or are they going to spend $100 million on a giant bricks and mortar project that is somehow going to educate all of the kids in the area? Now, one of the better ways of looking at this is, can we create a charter school where it costs less to operate, but they have more freedom and flexibility, and they're held to higher standards? Is it possible to do something like an opportunity scholarship program at the state level that I know some legislators, Democrats and Republicans, have tried but have not been able to succeed with? School choice does a lot of things. One of the things it does is it drives down administrative and bureaucratic costs by focusing on kids and making sure that we're spending our money where it needs to be spent, and that is in the classrooms, paying teachers what they deserve, what they should have earned, instead of shortchanging kids, shortchanging teachers, and spending a lot of money on construction and bureaucracy.
Well, not only that, Andrew, again, using Deptford as an example, from the year 2010 to the year 2015, school enrollments have actually dropped about 100 students per year.
We're seeing this all across the country. We're seeing communities where there are fewer students, but there is more money being spent. There are fewer students, but there are more administrators. There are fewer students, but they're building more schools. You have to wonder where are the priorities and who is setting them. At School Choice Week, we focus on celebrating what's working when parents have more options for their kids. So that's why during the week there's hundreds of events across New Jersey and thousands, tens of thousands of events across the country. Celebrating what works. We know school choice works. School choice helps us get our priorities back in order.
Andrew, National School Choice Week is January 24th through January 30th, 2016. I'm on your website right now, and it says School Choice Week will feature 16,140 events. What will take place at these events?
Everything from roundtable discussions about policy, and there are two big events in New Jersey, kickoff event and also a school choice summit, to open houses, to school fairs where parents can learn about their options, to student poster and essay contests, you name it. These events are independently planned, independently funded by schools, organizations, chambers of commerce, individuals. And the goal of these events is to let parents know that in many cases, they do have more choices than they might think when it comes to their education, and if they feel they want more choices, to have their voices heard.
Andrew, just please tell our audience where they can go, and we're not wrapping up the interview, just we're talking about the events, and tell our audience where they could go to find out about these events in New Jersey, in Pennsylvania, and in every state in the nation.
Absolutely. You can go to our website, which is schoolchoiceweek.com. There's a resource guide for parents. You can check it out and find out more about school choice. You can also use our interactive map, type in your zip code, and find out some events near you.
Hey, Andrew, could you hold on for just 2 minutes for a quick break?
Sure.
And you are listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at WNJC 1360 in Philly and around the world on the Internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio, and AMFM 24/7. Our guest this segment is Andrew Campanella. He's the president of National School Choice Week. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
You're so crazy. I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm messy, but I...
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the Internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back to Conservative Commandos Radio Show with George Landreth and Rick Trader. And for rebroadcasts of our shows, check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com, or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com, at 1 p.m., roarradio.net, at 9 p.m., highplainsdailynews.com. You could also hear our show from your telephone by calling 832 832- 1-800-799-1199. Our guest this segment is Andrew Campanella. He is the president of National School Choice Week. Andrew, thanks for holding through that break. We appreciate your time.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you.
Andrew, in 5 years, the idea of school choice certainly has grown, especially for National School Choice Week, that in the year 2011, there was 150 events, and this year there's over 16,000.
That's right. And, you know, I think the growth, this exponential growth we're seeing in the interest in School Choice Week tracks closely with the interest and demand we're seeing for school choice all across the country. More American families are actively choosing schools for their kids, and other families are seeing this and saying, I want school choice too. So supply and demand, it makes sense.
Here in the Conservative Commandos radio show, we are speaking with Andrew Campanella, president of National School Choice Week. National School Choice Week. And Andrew, I'm joined today by George Landreth. He's the president and CEO of Frontiers of Freedom. And George, there are a lot of people that say out there, oh, if parents had the choice of where to send their kids to school, that would ruin public education. What say you?
Well, one, I don't think that's true. I think that the odd thing is competition will make all schools better. So to the extent you have schools that are not performing well, I think that public schools will perform better as they begin to compete and they don't have a monopoly. Monopolists generally don't perform that well in terms of public service. I mean, think about it. If you only are allowed to have one hamburger joint in town, how motivated will they be to make sure your hamburger is tasty and hot and that they take good care of you and they're polite and smile and all those kinds of things? Or they even clean their restrooms, you know, that kind of stuff. But when you have competition, you bring your A game. So I would argue that it will help save public schools from themselves, quite frankly. And then I think the other thing that is interesting, and I'd be curious to find out what our guest thinks. I mean, maybe he agrees or disagrees with that, but I don't view school choice as a means of destroying public schools. We have school choice at the university level, and we still have university or government schools, and they tend to be very good ones. For example, you've got the University of Michigan, the University of Virginia. Those are two state schools that are that compare very favorably with your best private schools. So that, I think, is relevant.
Well, maybe, George, they have to. They have to, as you say, they have to compete with the private schools. So therefore, they have to be as good as any private school.
That's exactly my point. And the fact that we have public and private schools, and we have school choice when it comes to public, to college education, has not damaged or ended state schools. They are all over the country. Every state has them. Most states have multiple schools that are run by the state, and they are generally are better as a result of that competition. They're not put out of business.
And
I agree with that 100%. And I think when you look at school choice and you look at what the real goal here is, making sure kids get a good education, and then you look at what giving parents a choice does, and that means making all schools better because schools want to be the school of choice for kids. You know, George was right. We have the best higher education system in the world. People flock from countries all across the globe to come to the United States of America to send their kids to college. When you look at our K-12 education system, we're getting better, but we are still 22nd in the world when it comes to high school graduation rates. We are being outpaced by 22 other countries. At the end of World War II, we were number one. So we can improve our public schools. I think school choice celebrates public education because it adds more variety and diversity and choices within the public sector to public education. Because you think public schools, magnet schools, charter schools, online academies, they're all public schools.
Exactly. I think, and that's an important point. The other thing, too, is public schools don't exist just to exist. So when people say things like they'll struggle, the answer is, well, the ones that improve will not struggle. And the ones that continue to perform poorly will struggle, and it's okay, they probably should. They should go out of business and go away, because we all want our children to have a good education, and that we only want schools that are meeting their needs to succeed. If you had a college, for example, that gave out degrees that just cost students money but didn't prepare them in any way, shape, or form for the world that they're going to face to earn a better living or to be a better citizen or any of those kinds of things, it just sucked money out of them and then, sent them on with a piece of paper, eventually that school would go out of business if it were a university. But when it's a K through 12 exactly. thing, it just gets money pumped into it.
Yeah, and we have to look at this and say, if parents don't want one school for their kid, then they should be able to choose a different school. And really, in a lot of cases, you're not saying that that school is necessarily a bad school. You're just saying it's not a good school for my child. And
right.
what we
that's
find is that when schools are seeing lots of parents say that about them, they need to get better, and they need to do it more quickly. You know, we hear a lot in education about a 10-year plan. Well, a 10-year plan is so unhelpful to a kid who's a freshman in high school. That will not help them at all. So let's give them a choice right now.
Andrew, what about homeschooling? What's your opinion on people who want to homeschool their children?
I think it's fantastic. And in fact, you know, we celebrate all types of choice that parents have or want to be able to have for their kids. Homeschooling is one of them. It's the original school choice. Folks like Susan B. Anthony were homeschooled. Homeschooling is growing. We're seeing homeschooling grow by about 3% every year. And the results are in. Homeschooling students are scoring higher on the ACT and SAT. They have higher college entrance rates. They have higher college graduation rates. They have higher starting salaries when they get their first jobs. And all the myths about homeschooling, that kids don't have friends, that not socialized, have all been proven untrue. So homeschooling is a huge success story. And we have 808 events focused on homeschooling during School Choice Week, something I'm very proud of, because we've got to remember these parents are sacrificing a lot to educate their kids.
Andrew, do you think it's time that school systems and school districts should start to look at year-round schools? For instance, again, using this example of Deptford Township, about $22 million of this $100 million they want this bond issue for is to air condition every classroom. My thing is, well, when you look at the school year going from September to June, there's only about 5 days at the beginning of the school year, the 5 days at the end of the school year, where it's very hot in the classrooms, and there's very little teaching that goes on during that time. It seems to be every school needs to be air conditioned for those 10 days a year. Let's go to school those 12 months instead of 10.
I'm just going to be a dissenter and play devil's advocate on that, only because I don't know how much the air conditioning costs, but I remember, I'm from South Jersey, I remember going to school in May and June, you know, these are brick buildings, they were hot, I mean, it was hot, and it's difficult to learn. So anyway, we don't have a position on this at School Choice Week, I just remember back wishing we had air conditioning.
Well, if you're going to air condition in school, what about going to school year-round?
Sure. I think that there should be some schools that do it and some schools that don't, and parents should be able to choose the one that meets their kids' needs. I think that that is the essence of school choice, giving parents a variety of different choices in the types of schools, the different curriculum, different learning styles and different instructional styles, rather. And year-round schooling is something that parents might want to choose for their kids.
Have you seen movements? I'm sorry, George, you want to ask a question?
Well, I was just going to ask this question, because I think about, with kids, they come in different sizes and shapes. And so how many parents do you think out there buy one size fits all for their kids on everything? You know, whether it's, from shirts to pants to dresses, whatever it is. I mean, is that the way they buy their clothes for kids? Is there any evidence to suggest that a one size fits all approach is what they use?
Yeah, it's exactly right. And I like to tell people that.
And then the question is, are kids' bodies are actually, in my opinion, much more similar than their learning and their educational needs are. Those are actually substantially more diverse. And so I'm always puzzled why we've created a model where the thing that we're actually more similar on, meaning like eight-year-olds all actually do tend to be pretty close to the same size, that's the area where we don't have one-size-fits-all. But on education, where there's radically different needs and so forth, we don't. I've never been able to figure that one out.
It's important that we have choices. Every child is unique. Every child is different, has different interests, different things that challenge and motivate them. And like I said before, a school that might be great for one kid might not be good for another kid. So we can talk about failing schools, but really, for a parent, what a failing school is a school that's failing their child. What a great school is a school that's a great fit for their child. So let's not treat kids as if they are all cookie cutter the same, just like we don't treat ourselves like that. I mean, imagine in this country, if we told every adult you had to drink Folgers coffee in the morning and you weren't allowed to have Starbucks, you weren't allowed to have a different kind of coffee, I think people would march in the streets. You know, we like making choices. We like having variety. That is one of the best things about being an American, and we should be able to do that in K-12 education too, because it is the American way.
Andrew, we got about 2 minutes left. I wanted to give you the final minute to tell our audience how they could get involved and find out more about National School Choice Week. But could you take about 30 seconds to talk about the people that are opposed to school choice?
You know, I'll say this. I think that people who oppose school choice, what they essentially want is for parents to send their child to one school arbitrarily based on a zip code, based on a zone, based on an artificial boundary, whether or not that school is a good fit for that parent's kids. And what will happen to the kids who are going to this school that's not a good fit for them? Will they drop out? High school dropouts earn $250,000 less in the course of their life than kids who have a diploma. They're six times less likely to vote, far more likely to be incarcerated. The unemployment rate for high school dropouts is 30.4%. We need to do better. School choice gives parents the opportunity to give their kids essentially a ticket to the American dream. So for folks who oppose this, I want you to look at the next generation and say, you know what? We don't care if you graduate. No one can say that to a kid.
No.
Every child has potential.
And Andrew and Campanella, anyone who wants more information about school choice or National School Choice Week, please tell them where they can go.
Go to schoolchoiceweek.com. We also want folks to join our social media campaign, schoolchoiceweek.com/tweet, and help get school choice trending.
Andrew, you know I'm in your camp, Campanella.
Thank you very much.
Great to have you back. Take care. God bless.
Thank you. You too.
And you are listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360 in Philly, and around the world on the internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio Rebooting, Liberty Radio, AM/FM 24/7, and a whole bunch of others. Don't go away. On the other side, we're going to be speaking with Ryan Young from the Competitive Enterprise Institute. Be right back.
You've heard Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters Morning Show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses, such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years of experience to work for you, as choosing the right option for your situation can be critical. Call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485904.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems programs, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCS for automation.com. That's PCS, the number four, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
We're back. This is George Landreth and Rick Trader and the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. If you would like to hear broadcast of today's show, rebroadcast, please check out our website at www.ccrsnetwork.com and www.ccrsnetwork.com. ccrshow.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., you can log into leadingedgeradionetwork.com. Or at 1 p.m., you can log on to www.roarradio.net. And, at, of course, at 2 p.m., you can log on to the highplainsdailynews.com. And now you can listen to the Conservative Commandos from any phone by calling 832-999-1199. Well, we promised that we would get to Ryan, and we've got him on the phone. Ryan Young is the Competitive Enterprise Institute's fellow focusing on regulatory and monetary policy and financial regulation. He also hosts CEI's, that's Competitive Enterprise Institute's, weekly podcast, and he writes their popular Regulation of the Day piece. His work has been featured in publications like USA Today, Politico, Investors Business Daily, and many other publications around the country. And prior to joining the team full-time, he was CEI's Warren T. Brooks Journalism Fellow, and he worked at Cato Institute's Government Affairs Department. Ryan, welcome to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show.
Thanks for having me on.
Well, Ryan, you actually have written a very interesting article, and you do a lot of interesting things on regulation. And you kind of, in this article, lay out how regulations are getting out of control and how the left often uses courts and kind of these disingenuous settlements, these collusive settlements, to advance and further essentially burden the American public with all kinds of regulations. Rather than me telling folks, why don't we have it get it straight from the horse's mouth? Not that you're a horse, but you know the saying. And kind of tell us what's going on. How bad is the regulatory thing? You know, is it really out of hand, or is it just a bunch of presidential candidates and you know, talking heads like me that just bemoan it?
No, I think the problem is reaching epic proportions. Let me put it this way. Every time a regulation is passed by an agency, it gets published in a daily digest called the Federal Register. Last year alone, that Federal Register reached 82,000 pages. That set an all-time record, which goes back all the way to 1936.
And this isn't like big print with lots of pictures, right? We're not talking about like Dr. Seuss pages, right?
No, small type, three-column text. I've done some analysis.
And it's all scintillating too, right?
Oh yeah, it's dreck. But yeah, all in all, you add up all the regulations, it's 175,000 pages, and it costs about $1.9 trillion. So while the presidential candidates are talking tax and budget and health care and immigration and foreign policy, regulations are a $2 trillion problem, which means that the federal government is actually half, again, as big as most people think it is.
Well, that's an interesting point. So when they talk about, oh, we can cut this tax, and they say it'll save the taxpayer $100 billion, that sounds like a big number to us, $100 billion. I'm not saying it's not a big number, but if they would get these regulations under control, they could actually save us way, way more, because you just said trillion, I heard.
Yes, yeah, trillion with a T.
Yeah, that's incredible. And so you're basically talking about a tremendous, effectively, if you will, I'll use the word tax cut, in other words, boon to the economy to see it grow, because we've essentially reduce this unneeded burden. Now, anytime someone talks about doing that, however, they always act like, oh, so you want people to die. You want bad things to happen. So why don't you just very quickly tell us, you know, there's probably some regulations that make sense. I often use the analogy of traffic lights. If you place them properly in the right places in the right amount of time, they actually increase the traffic flow and make things better. But if you put them everywhere and you screw up the timing so they don't work right, then you make, you know, grind everything to a halt. So I don't know that we would argue there should be zero regulation, but having said that, we are well past the point of regulations being helpful. So if you cut regulations the way you and I think perhaps needs to be done, are people going to be dying in the street? Will children be suffering? Will the disadvantaged be you know, taken advantage of? Will the world, as you know, the modern world as we know it, cease to exist?
The short answer is no.
Right. I kind of set you up for the answer there. But.
Yeah, but if you think about it, though, if you look at, say, fuel economy regulations for cars, the easiest way to make a car more fuel efficient is to make it more lightweight. And a lighter car is not as safe in a crash. So my employer, the Competitive Enterprise Institute, actually filed a lawsuit about this some years ago. And we forced the Transportation Department to admit in court that their regulations literally kill people. So in some sense, we would have fewer people dying in the streets under the kind of regulatory regime that you and I envision.
Exactly. I think that's an important point. That there's some things you can do efficiency-wise that improves mileage, but the easiest way to get a better mileage car is make it smaller and lighter, and the smaller and lighter that vehicle is, the less safe you are. And there are now reliable studies that demonstrate that literally, you know, every time they up the CAFE standards by corporate average fuel economy standards by a mile, it will cost us X number of thousands of lives.
Yeah, so I mean, we call that death by regulation, and while those kinds of rules that actually cost lives are the exception and not the rule, and I agree with you that there are some reasonable regulations out there that should be kept, I was delighted to see that in the last couple of weeks, Congress has actually passed a couple of bills to reform regulations and rein them in. One of them, if it succeeds, might actually save as much as $300 billion.
That would be awesome. Again,
yeah.
We're talking big money.
Yeah, huge money. And the trouble is, because of all the focus on other issues, regulations getting lost in the pile. And it's as important as any issue there is out there.
Right. Well, tell us a little about how the courts are sometimes used in these kind of what you might call disingenuous court settlements are used to legitimize essentially rules and regulations that they probably couldn't ordinarily get through, but they sneak them through as part of a court settlement.
Sure. So suppose the EPA has a regulation that phases in over time and has different deadlines for when they have to act. A lot of times they'll design those deadlines to be deliberately unrealistic, so that way an activist group can sue the EPA and say, hey, you guys aren't meeting your deadlines, you're not enforcing a regulation strictly enough or broadly enough. And it might even turn out in some cases that the activist groups in the EPA are actually in cahoots the whole time. So EPA gets sued and they happily admit their guilt. Yes, we haven't done our job. And then they agree to a settlement that expands the size and scope of EPA power. It's a way of essentially to regulate without going through the traditional rulemaking process where they have to publish the text of the rule. There's a period of review for the public to look over it and offer comments. It's a way to avoid legal transparency requirements, and I think it's a detriment to the quality of regulation.
Well, you hit that, I think, right on the head there, because one of the things that you see happening increasingly is as the EPA is being increasingly essentially a leftward-leaning organization, they've been very willing and very cooperative. I mean, I've got friends that work over there, and, you know, example would be you guys try to get information from the EPA, and they stonewall you and stonewall you and stonewall you and try to deny you information that you're legally entitled to. And then some other group, some lefty group, will call them up and say, we think you should be regulating even more. And they say, you know what? I think you're right. We probably should acquire more power and regulate more. We'll agree to that. You sue us. And yeah, absolutely. We will agree to regulate even more and grab more power. And then this is somehow viewed as legitimate. And to me, this is a big problem. The whole regulatory state is out of hand. As somebody who's taught constitutional law, unlike our president, who didn't actually teach constitutional law, in case people were wondering, they often say that. He had a seminar he taught, and it was on activists, how to train activists, and they had a section in which they talked about how to use the Constitution as a means of doing that, but they didn't actually teach constitutional law. But I did, and you know, we have a separation of powers, and the legislature is supposed to make the law. And we've gotten away from that. When you have last year, I don't know how many laws Congress passed, but I know it was under 100. And then you had the literally tens of thousands of pages of regulations that they released, the government, you know, the administrative branches. You have to ask, who's making the law nowadays? It sure as heck ain't Congress.
Hey, Ryan, you know, one question I wanted to ask before we go to a break, and we have to take a two-minute break. I hope you can stay through that and continue the conversation on the other side. But who keeps tracks of all these laws and regulations, all these thousands and thousands of pages of regulations? Who keeps track of them all? How can anybody keep track of them all?
It's a hodgepodge, and it's an ineffective hodgepodge at that. Formally, regulations are supposed to be published in the Federal Register, which is published daily. And last year, that reached 82,000 pages, all-time record. But that doesn't always happen. That sue and settle bit we were talking about with the activist groups suing the EPA and other agencies, that's off of the books, and that bill that the House passed to reform sue and settle abuses would at least require settlement terms to be published so that way the public can read them and they don't stay hidden. But yeah, there are lots of other abuses that we can talk about after the break.
All right, hold on please just for 2 minutes. And you are listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at WNJC 1360 Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio, AMFM, and a whole bunch of others. Our guest this segment is Ryan Young from the Competitive Enterprise Institute, and we're talking about reforming regulation in 2016. Be right back.
Yeah, that's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I...
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-851-7575.
857-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
The Conservative Commandos are back. And if you would like to hear a rebroadcast of today's shows, please check out our websites at www.ccrsnetwork.com or www.ccrshow.com. And, of course, in the mornings at 9 a.m., you can log in to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. And at 1 p.m., you can log in to www.roarradio.net. And at 2 p.m., you can log on to highplainsdailynews.com. And you have one more way to get a hold of us, and that is you can listen to the Conservative Commandos on any phone by dialing 832-999-1199. Well, before we went to the break, Rick and I were talking with Ryan Young at the Competitive Enterprise Institute. He's agreed to stay over for this segment. And we've been talking about the number of regulations. And Ryan gave us the idea, pointed out that there were over 82,000 pages of regulations, that there were only, that Congress, however, only passed 87 bills. So it gives you an idea that most of the rules and laws that are being passed nowadays are not actually coming from your elected representatives. And so we've been talking about what to do about it. And maybe that's what we should focus on now is what are some of the best solutions to this problem? I mean, if you were to kind of give us a short laundry list of things that would help, what would make that list?
I would say that a bill that the House passed about 2 weeks ago might be the single most effective thing that could that they could do. If the total cost of regulation is about $1.9 trillion per year, well, there's one bill that would require a commission to comb through the code of federal regulations and save about 15% of total federal regulatory costs. By my math, that's about $285 billion at a minimum that this could save every year. It would free innovation, it would clean old, obsolete, or redundant rules out of the books. The bill is called the Scrub Act. It passed the House. It, the administration has issued a veto threat, and we'll see what the Senate does. If anything, I would love to see the Senate pass the bill and send it to the president's desk, so that way if he does reject the bill, he would have to offer a public explanation as to why he opposes those savings. But if you think about it, the Code of Federal Regulations, this is where all federal rules are stored, in theory at least. You can order a copy from the government printing office, and they will send you 238 volumes totaling more than 175,000 pages. And it also includes an index that just by itself is about 1,200 pages. And the Scrub Act bill would task an independent commission with combing through all of that over the next several years for rules that are old, obsolete, harmful, redundant. They would send that package to Congress, which would then be required to vote on it. And then, in theory, that could save in the neighborhood of $300 billion every year for the economy. If you think about what,
so not just a one-time savings of $300 billion, but each year it would give us $300 billion savings in our economy.
That's absolutely right. And if you think about what that can do for job creation, for living standards,
so if you score that over 10 years like they do some of the bills when they want to tell us how much they saved,
yeah, you're talking to me like potentially $3 trillion or more. Trillion with a T.
Yeah, wow. I would love to hear the president explain why that's a bad idea.
As would I, so hopefully that'll come to fruition.
Well, Rick, do you want to come in and do you have a few questions?
Yeah, Ryan, what is the history of regulations being reversed? I mean, as you're talking, you know, we have thousands of new regulations every year. But do we ever see where I know you're talking about some bills that are in the House and Senate right now to reverse this trend. But do we ever see bills, regulations reversed?
If someone was to write a history of regulations being reversed, it would be short. For example, the only example I can think of in recent history is from the Clinton years. They had a set of ergonomics regulations for office equipment, chairs, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. There's a safeguard in place called the Congressional Review Act, where if an agency goes rogue and passes something crazy, Congress can hold a vote and say, no, thank you. They've done that precisely once since those days, there have probably been 40 to 50,000 regulations passed.
Holy mackerel.
One repeal. Do the math as far as percentage.
And you said there was 81,000 pages of regulations?
Yeah, just over 82,000.
82. I don't know, crazy question, but have you ever done the math? If you stack these pages on top of each other, how high that stack would be?
I did. If you go for the data from 1994 through about 2013, that's a nice even 20-year chunk. It would be, 476 feet tall. So if you add up the last couple of years in addition with last year's record-setting total added to it, Washington Monument is 550 feet tall.
Holy mackerel. So it's almost as tall as the Washington Monument.
Which has been around since the 1830s, and just the last 20-some years would rival its height.
Oh, my gosh. Now, Ryan, in your article, you talked about if rules costing under $99 million per year, they try to keep these rules under $99 million per year because it escapes scrutiny?
That's exactly right. There's a legal classification called significance that regulations can be subject to. And if a regulation ends up costing $100 million or more in a given year, then it meets that, and that triggers review by the Office of Management and Budget. And just that level of scrutiny is something that a lot of agencies just want to avoid. They don't want that kind of stuff becoming public. So, yeah, you see a lot of lowballing of cost estimates. You see a lot of other chicanery trying to avoid those transparency requirements, to the point where out of, say, 3,400, 3,500 rules in an average year, only 40 to 50 meet that economically significant standard and actually are expected to proper cost.
Ryan, whenever I hear things like this, I love to think of what would the founding fathers do if they came back and saw all this government and regulation. I swear they'd have another revolution. I really mean that. Ryan Young, Competitive Enterprise Institute, we want to thank you for joining us today. Please tell our audience where they could read your article and get more information.
Sure. CEI.org, the Competitive Enterprise Institute. We're a think tank based in Washington, D.C. So for more information, see CEI.org. Thanks for having me on.
Ryan Young, thank you. Take care. God bless. And you are listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at WNJC, 1360 AM in Philadelphia. And around the world on the internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio, AMFM 24/7, whole bunch of other places. Don't go away on the other side. We're going to be speaking with Kyle Felcher, and we're going to be talking about lead in water. Be right back.
You've heard Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters Morning Show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses, such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years years of experience to work for you. As choosing the right option for your situation can be critical, call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485904.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Boswell's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems programs, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCS for automation.com. That's PCS, the number four, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with George Landreth and yours truly, Rick Trader. And for rebroadcasts of our shows, check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com. Mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. At 1 p.m., roarradio.net. At 9 p.m., highplainsdailynews.com. You could also hear our show from your telephone by calling 832 832- 888-999-1199. And joining us now is Kyle Falcher. And I think, Kyle, is that the correct pronunciation?
You nailed it.
Right. Kyle Falcher, he's an energy and environmental reporter with the Washington Examiner. He previously covered state education policy out of the Michigan Capitol, and we're welcoming him here to Conservative Commandos. Thanks for joining us, Kyle.
And thanks so much for having me.
Kyle, we've asked you to join us to discuss your article and something that's going on out there in Michigan about Michigan officials downplaying lead in the water. Now, Kyle, I need to get this bad joke out of the way first and foremost. We got water in the Flint River. Is that really because Michael Moore took a bath in it?
You know, I'm not sure. It might be one of his ancestors. So it's been polluted for quite some time. I think before he was even alive.
All right. Well, on to more serious stuff. Please tell our audience about this whole issue of lead being in the water system in Flint, Michigan, and why it's important.
So this is kind of a failure of governance across all fronts by, you know, both parties, everyone involved. This all started a couple years ago when the city of Flint, at that point under the control of the state of Michigan, due to a kind of unique law that they have there in the state, the city decided to switch its water supply. It had been taking water from the Detroit system for many, many years, but in order to save a couple million dollars, they decided to go to a local authority. But they didn't have the infrastructure for that local authority set up yet to bring Flint online, so they had to switch to the Flint River in the meantime. And so it's been a temporary thing that's going to happen for a couple years.
Mm-hmm.
Since then, this switch happened in April 2014, and within a month or two, Flint residents started complaining about the water. It was brown. It smelled bad. It tasted bad. It wasn't reacting the same way as the old water did to stuff like dish soap.
Mm-hmm.
So they essentially brought their complaints to their city representatives, and their city representatives didn't have any power because of the state law that had put an emergency manager in charge. So there were some tests done. They tested the water at the water treatment plant and in the river itself. Those tests didn't show anything wrong, didn't show anything abnormal. Of course, what the problem was is that the water there is so acidic that it would go through the water treatment plant, and then it go through the iron pipes that go through the city and go to lead pipes, the lead pipes bringing the water to the actual homes of the city. And when it went to the homes, the water is so acidic that it would eat off the corrosion control that was there, and then it would eat off the lead pipes itself and bring the lead pipes into people's homes. And this had been going on for about a year, and eventually it came to the state's attention. For what the emails that were released yesterday showed is that they downplayed it for months on end, probably about 6 or 7 months before it suddenly became a crisis that they needed to deal with, and they've been on the back foot ever since October when they started really acting on this.
Wow, lead pipes, you know. Kyle, I was in Pompeii, the city that was destroyed by the volcano, 2,000, 3,000 years ago.
Right.
And they use lead pipes there. My gosh, I can remember 40 years ago when I was working as a plumber's helper. Even at that time, they were using plastic piping for water supplies. I'm thinking before that they use iron and copper. But lead pipe, I mean, the water system itself must be antiquated in Flint.
Oh, the infrastructure there, as it is with so many of these Michigan, industrial towns that were basically fueled by the auto industry, and when those left, kind of took away a lot of taxpayer money, a lot of tax dollars that would have gotten, come from these companies. There was no money to update infrastructure. General Motors used to be based in Flint. When General Motors left Flint in the late 1980s, it took away one of the town's major employers. There used to be 80,000 people employed by General Motors in Flint. Now there's about 8,000, 10,000 people employed by General Motors in Flint. So there was simply no money for the city to update its infrastructure, but they didn't ever think there was a need because there had been no problem. The Detroit Water was the Detroit Water had this corrosion control chemical in it. The lead pipes worked fine. Nothing had ever gone wrong. And then once the switch is made, all these past decisions kind of came home to roost.
You know, Kyle, back in the 1800s, I think in 1859, there was a British expedition on it's called the Franklin Expedition. They were trying to find a water route, the Northwest Passage, and this expedition failed. Consequently, they found the graves of three of the people that died in this expedition. They found that these men died of lead poisoning, and how the reason they died from lead poisoning, this was in the early days of canning food, and the cans were sealed with lead that leached into the food, that when they ate it got into their bodies, and that's what caused these people to die. Now,
right.
It's widely known what lead poisoning will do to you. Just the fact that they still depend on lead pipes for a water source.
Right.
It's just mind-boggling.
Yes, this is a place where the story of Detroit is a little bit more well known, I think, across the country.
Right.
Knowing that, you know, how a city government can fail so completely that it ends up, you know, declaring bankruptcy. Flint is a miniature version of Detroit. It's about 100,000 people, but it has the same governance issues. It had the same population issues. It had the same sort of infrastructure issues. The government there has struggled to provide basic city services for the last 40 years, let alone spend the amount of money that it would take to update this infrastructure. The mayor there recently said it might cost over $1 billion to have to update all these pipes and to update the water infrastructure, which is, you know, that's not $1 billion, a one-time expense. That's $1 billion that has built up for years and years and years of just of ignoring the system, essentially.
Is there a volcano near Flint, Michigan that could possibly cover it over and solve this problem?
There is not. I think the best hope for that might be that Lake Huron eventually swallows it, but I don't think that either of those are likely in the near future.
You know,
let's cut to the quick, though.
Well, George, can we do that after the break?
Okay, sure. I just want to make sure we get in. It's George Bush's fault.
Okay. Hey, Kyle, we got to take a 2-minute break. Could you hold on for us for just 2 minutes? We want to continue this conversation with you. Unbelievable. And you are listening to Conservative Commandos with George Landreth and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at WNJC in Philly and around the world on the internet with American Patriots Broadcasting, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio, AM/FM 24/7. And a whole bunch of others. And we're speaking with Kyle Felcher. He is a reporter with the Washington Examiner. We're talking about the polluted water in Flint, Michigan, all caused by Michael Moore and racism. Be right back.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back to Conservative Commandos Radio Show with George Landreth and yours truly, Rick Trader. And for rebroadcast of our shows, we don't want you to forget, you can check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m. Eastern, log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. At 1 p.m., roarradio.net. At 9 p.m., highplainsdailynews.com. You could also hear our show from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. Our guest this segment is Kyle Felcher. He's an energy and environmental reporter with the Washington Examiner. And we're discussing his article, Michigan Officials Downplay Lead Water Crisis. Kyle, thanks for holding through that break.
Hey, not a problem.
Hey, Kyle, I'll tell you, somebody who's not downplaying this. It's the favored son of Flint, Michigan, Michael Moore, who has an op-ed on Time.com, and I'll read you the first part of the paragraph to you because a lot of people might get going into the break. I mentioned Michael Moore and racism.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he has an op-ed on Time that says, "The people of my hometown, Flint, Michigan, are being poisoned. Let me not mince words. This is a racial crime. If it were to happen in another country, we would call it ethnic cleansing. Flint is a very poor, majority African-American city, and the Republican governor of Michigan, Rick Snyder, knows they have no political power, no lobbyists, no money. They didn't vote for him. So this is racist now."
You know, I think that's some very strong language from Mr. Moore. I'm not sure if I would go so far as to call this ethnic cleansing, but there has definitely been a racial element to this. A lot of people have raised the question if this would have happened in a different place, such as a wealthy suburb of Detroit like Bloomfield Hills, where...
If it happened in Bloomfield Hills, I'm sure the government in Bloomfield Hills would raise taxes, raise a bond issue, and fix the problem. However, in Flint, Michigan, where it's apparently, I've never been there, don't know a lot about it, but apparently this is a very poor town. And, you know, Kyle, I would make the argument that's what happens when, as you say, the tax base moves out.
Sure, absolutely. You know, like I said, that there has been, the people have asked that question. I don't think they realize that the governance structure, the local governance structures in places like Bloomfield Hills or in other wealthier parts of Michigan are simply much stronger. And, maybe this doesn't get past that point. But like you said, this is much more this is an economic problem as much as anything. The fact that, this, you know, Flint, Michigan has been based off of one industry, and you know, when that industry went away, it made many, you know, it brought financial problems to the very forefront of what Flint, you know, what Flint had to worry about. And so this is much more of a economics issue and an economics issue and a finance issue. But there is definitely, you know, in Michigan, this is a question that's being raised. You know, would this happen to a whiter city?
Well, you know, I want to bring George Landreth into this conversation. George, I think it's a little bit more than an economic thing. It's also a severe health issue. And I'm reading from Kyle's article that says, a study by the Hurley Medical Center found the amount of children with too much lead in their system rose from 2% to 4.1% after the change in water supply. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, George, but doesn't that sound like this is becoming a serious health issue too?
It does sound like it. One of the things that I find that's kind of odd is Michael Moore acts as if this is something that the governor did by mentioning him. And I'm sure that if you go through all the laws, in some sense, at some point, the governor in his office probably had some interface on this. But primarily, water is typically a local issue. And I find it interesting that I jokingly before the break said, you know, it's probably George Bush's fault. Were George Bush in office, I have no doubt Michael Moore would have mentioned him as well. And I'm not saying that the governor's office couldn't have handled some things better, but I do find it curious that everyone acts as if somehow this is first and foremost a failure on the governor's part. That seems a little bit hard for me to believe. It seems like a lot of people failed before it got to him.
You know, that's definitely what, when you look at the political realities of it, the governor in the 300 pages of emails that were released yesterday, I think the governor had actually sent about 7 of them. He had not, he had kind of left it to his environmental people, to the state treasurer's office, the people who would be making the financial decisions about Flint. So if anything, what the governor might be guilty of here is trusting his lieutenants too much to do the job, and obviously these are people he appointed and that he assigned jobs to. But there doesn't appear to be anything where Governor Snyder said, "Let's switch to this water," or "Let's put lead in the water," or anything like that. There's no smoking gun in that kind of sense. But I think that's what in Michigan, Democrats there have been out of power for some time. And they are looking for someone to blame, and they're going after the top dog in the state. And Governor Snyder has certainly been that now for about 5-6 years.
I think the pressing question is were there any? Did he send or receive any emails that were marked top secret?
That's the question that really has to be answered here. There were these emails that were released yesterday, but in Michigan, state law makes it so that the governor's emails and all state lawmen, all of their communications are exempt from the Freedom of Information Act, meaning that it's up to them what they release to the public. So what we saw yesterday is what the governor chose to release. Is there more? That's a question that has to be answered. You know, they're saying that no, this is everything. This is every email regarding Flint that we've dealt with within the last 2 years. And the people
well,
trust
and,
that?
And my
sure.
reference to marked top secret, of course, is actually more of a reference. If this were Hillary, of course, we would not be getting anything at all, and we'd be getting a bunch of garbage out of it.
Exactly. You know, that's what some people have said. The emails that have been released about from Hillary Clinton have come from a Freedom of Information Act request because the federal government allows that sort of thing, and it came from a lawsuit that pressed the issue. We can't do that. With these Michigan laws.
Interesting.
Hey, Kyle, being a native son of Michigan, do you see this as potentially harming Snyder?
You know, it definitely does. It harms his, I hate to sound like this, but it harms his brand, really, which has been this, he kind of positions himself in Michigan as above the fray. He's a problem solver. He doesn't play political games. He's not, he was a businessman before this, so he was, he's not a politician. He's a, you know, he was a businessman who wanted to get things done. He wanted to come in and fix things in Michigan. And, people have been able to point to certain things that he's done while in office, and not, they've been unhappy with him. But there's nothing, Michigan has been getting better than it was under the previous administration. But now this scandal really kind of takes the wind out of his sails a little bit, and it's really his first really big scandal in his administration. There's been some other things that, but nothing that's going to be on the front page of the New York Times or going to be leading network news or anything like that. So nationwide. So this is something that I think does harm him. Whether or not it's enough to make him resign, I don't know. But I think it's definitely going to hurt him, hurt his political brand in the future.
Yeah. Kyle Felcher, we want to thank you so much for... by the way, have they warned people not to drink the water? I mean, what precautions
have been... Oh, yeah, absolutely. So what they've been doing since October is handing out thousands upon thousands of water filters that you can kind of snap on to your, mm-hmm. to your faucet there. Mm-hmm. People can filter the water out. They've switched the water source back to Detroit since out of the Flint River, but it takes a while for the corrosion control to come back up and start working on the pipes again.
Right.
So people are being urged to definitely filter their water and avoid bathing in it or that kind of thing as much as they possibly can. So
yeah,
definitely some hoops people have to jump through still.
Yeah, I'm not going to visit Flint, Michigan anytime soon, but Kyle Felcher, want to thank you so much for joining us today. Please tell our audience how they could follow your work.
Absolutely. Go to WashingtonExaminer.com. You can find me there. And if you want to follow me on Twitter, my Twitter handle is Kyle_Felcher. Thank you so much.
Kyle, great to have you with us. Take care. God bless.
Thank you.
George, I want to thank you for sitting in today as my co-host. We have about 30 seconds. George, final thoughts?
The only final thought I guess I have here is this isn't just the stories that... The connection point of all these stories is that the government, when it gets big and out of control, always disappoints. It often lacks accountability, and it often doesn't seem to care that much about the lives of the people it's governing. And so this is why you should be a conservative, because you've got to keep an eye on government. We need some government, but we got to keep an eye on it and make it accountable.
And don't rely on government. Hey, George, again, thank you so much. I also want to thank our other guests today for joining us here on Conservative Commandos, Andrew Campanella from National School Choice Week, Ryan Young from the Competitive Enterprise Institute, our most recent guest, Kyle Felcher from the Washington Examiner. Always want to thank Mr. John Forsythe Jr. for working the boards. We might not see Snowflake John for about a week, but for right now, we're out of time. We got to run. We got to go. Take care. God bless. We'll see you next week on the radio.
I really